The next contest in a Better Photography Weekly challenge is Kitchen Sim Life. Our judge and mentor is Mr. Jagdish Agarwal. The father of Indian photography, Mr. Agarwal established the very first professional picture agency in the country in 1987, Dinodia Photo Library, which is still growing. He has received nearly 50 awards, both nationally and internationally. He has held 14 solo exhibitions in India and the US, as well as exhibited in prestigious galleries around the world. He has also nurtured and mentored countless photographers. He has devoted his Saturday afternoons to discussions with them and organized motivational camps, weekly art walks, and an annual photography exhibition for upcoming artists. Hello, sir. Welcome.
Thank you for your kind words. So, I thank you, Niloufar, for inviting me to be the mentor and the judge. And this month's contest, Kitchen Still Life, is very interesting because I have one of my pictures taken some years and years ago, which is very popular. And I've sold it a number of times for homes where they put it in the dining area. So I thought, yes, it will be a good opportunity to tell photographers that since we are all locked down, we are all home actually, and nothing like taking pictures in your house. Like you can take pictures of your kitchen one day not one day, but a kitchen can be a monthly program. You can take your bedroom once, you can take your toilet once, you can take your living room once. So you can go ahead like this. So today we are doing kitchen. So the first thing you must do is identify in your house only where you can put up a print of your kitchen. So if you have a dining area where you have a wall which is empty, like you can see in this picture, there are two frames on the right wall. So the moment you have identified a wall, you know roughly what size of picture you need. Do you need a vertical? Do you need a horizontal? And what will look good, a color or a black and white? So once you have identified that, then the second step is you must go out and buy colored paper. You can go to a local stationery shop, and they have all colors, but you must get, let's say, white, you must get gray, you must get black, and you must get all the primary colors, violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange, red. So once you have all the colored papers, find a nice window in your house where you can get backlight or say side light, and take a table. You don't need any lights actually, just window light is enough. So you can set up a tabletop studio with a table and the colored paper, and then pick up the items from your kitchen one by one, place them there, and see, do you find anything artistic in that? Is the color interesting? Is the shape interesting? Is the pattern interesting? And see what best you can do with it, and which colored paper will look best with it. Of course, here, one more thing, you might need a macro lens. If you don't have a macro lens, you can use extension rings. If you don't even have that, I remember I once had a reversal ring which goes on your camera and your lens is reversed, and that works like a close-up lens. So you can do anything, or if you don't have anything, you can use the minimum focusing distance of your lens. You set your camera, your lens to the minimum focusing distance, and then you move forward and backwards and see where your object is sharp. And then you can go ahead. So I'll show you some pictures. Like, see now, suppose you have this corner, then you know that you need a vertical picture. And the previous picture was you could use a horizontal picture there. Now I'll show you one by one. Next. So colored paper. You must buy colored paper. All colors that you can get, they are very cheap. That's not not expensive, and you can use it for all tabletops. It is always better to buy a paper which is slightly thick, so that it doesn't crumple easily. You know, you can get I think 300 GSM papers, or if you tell him that you need chart paper, then it is quite thick. So buy all the colored papers, and then next. So this is what happens when you use a macro lens. You go so close that for a moment the viewer cannot make out what it is. Like, I don't know if you can make out what this is. This is a spice called what's it called? I'm forgetting the name. Star anise. Yes, okay. This is called star anise. Yes. So you have gone so close that it becomes an abstract. So you can open your fridge and select all the fruits one by one, all the vegetables one by one. You can open the cutlery drawer and select all the spoons, all the knives, you know, whatever you can find, and see if you can get an interesting close-up. Okay, next. There you are, white paper. There's a simple, just a green chili, but see how graphic it is, how beautiful it is. Now, this picture, if you see carefully, this picture, if you see carefully, I call this as taking a picture from the ant eye view. You know, think that you are an ant, and the ant is crawling on the floor. So what will the ant see? So ant will see the green chili like this. So, you know, once you know that, okay, I want to have an ant eye view, then you can put your camera or your tripod at the appropriate height, and you can get this picture. And see, this simple backlight, you know, window light is enough actually. Yes, next. You know, that's a gray paper. So you have shining stainless steel spoons and you have a gray paper. So here the picture is a black and white. So, you know, you can make out, okay, this picture will look good in black and white. This picture will look good in color. And what makes this picture interesting is that the spoons are not straight. You know, the spoon has a nice curve there. And he has combined two spoons to make it look graphic and to make it look interesting. So think and see there, that's a black paper. Now, I remember when I was learning drawing in my school, you know, we used to have a lesson where we had to draw something black and yellow, black and red. So we know that it is attractive, like the taxis in Bombay. Why are they black and yellow? Because they look attractive and you can see them from far. And see here, the photographer has how nicely combined a blue spoon there. So you have warm color and you have a cold color, and then the formation, the graphic shape, two spoons going from the left, one spoon coming from the right. So you can make your picture as interesting as possible. And this angle, I would say is a mosquito eye view. Think that you are a mosquito or a fly on the wall and how it will look from the top. So since it's a close-up, you can play around with your camera. You can see how it looks from the left, from the right, from the top, from the bottom, from all the angles. In fact, I think there is a studio in I think America somewhere, where they place an object on a table or on a floor or somewhere, and the camera can take picture from anywhere. You know, they have a globe and there are hundreds and thousands of cameras there, and they take a picture from every degree. So they can take 360 pictures of that object. And then they put it on a computer and they can give you 3D models and they can do all kinds of things. That is how today car photography is done. You know, that is why most of the car photographers, the amount of work they had, say 10, 20 years ago, that work has gone down because of that. Okay, next. See, yellow on yellow. I love this simply. So you can choose a color paper which is matching with the fruit or vegetable, or you can choose a contrasty color. Like, you know, with this yellow, even a blue or a green would have looked, you know, would have looked interesting, because there is a green stem of the pepper. So even a green would look nice, but see how beautiful yellow on yellow looks. And see, look at the composition. You know, there are three lemons and one pepper. So you have to be very, very careful with your composition, because you have all the time. You can play around. Okay. See, there you are. Now there's a blue background, and again, lovely composition. How he has put, you know, different colors, different shapes, different sizes, and how he has spaced them. Again, this is a fly view, you know, taken from a mosquito view. You can also play around with your exposure. See here, this is a, you know, we call this a background image. So this can be used as a background. But see how beautifully he has combined warm color and cold color. So you have a red chili which has a green stem, and he has placed them so beautifully, you know. And there's to offset all the chilies, he has a lovely curved chili on the left hand side, which looks marvelous actually. Okay, you will have a window in your house where you get sunlight. So this picture is with the sunlight shadow. So the moment you have a, you know, window where sunlight comes, maybe for half an hour or 1 hour or 2 hours, you can make pictures of shadows like this, and they look beautiful. So just imagine there's a window above and sunlight is coming, or even I think if the sunlight is not there, you might get a shadow like this. Again, you can match the color, you know, you can, after you have done fruits and vegetables and the cutlery, you can look at the glasses, the cups, the saucers, pick up anything and see how beautifully he has matched the color of the, I think it's a glass or whatever, and with the background, and how you know, graphic it looks. Beautiful. Ah, that's very interesting. See if you can impart an emotion to your picture. Here, the way he has taken these two cherries, red cherries, and the stem he has put in such a way that it looks like a heart. So he's conveying emotion of love. So if you look at fruits and vegetables carefully with a closed eye, you know, with an open eye, you can find shapes in them. You know, you can find the most common is, if you take a pepper, you can get the back of a woman, you know, back of a nude woman. In fact, if you remember, there's a very famous photograph by, if I'm not mistaken, by Edward Weston, where he has taken a picture of a green pepper. So it's a black and white. And I remember reading about it. He wanted the whole pepper sharp. So in those days, there were cameras, I think up to 64 aperture. But in 64, he was not getting the full pepper sharp. So he made a camera with 128 aperture, and that is how he was able to get that paper sharp from the top to the bottom. And that picture is world famous, and it's a simple tabletop actually. So look at the fruits and vegetables carefully. I remember we had once done a exhibition of fruits and vegetables that looked like different animals or birds, you know. So we had a potato that looked like the back of a cow. We had a brinjal that looked like a penguin. We had a Karela. Karela is what? It is bitter gourd, bitter gourd, which looked like a bird. Then we had beans that looked like snake. If you look at fruits and vegetables carefully, you can get lovely pictures. Okay. Again, you know, don't you know, look at only fruits, vegetables, or cutlery. Look at other things, small things in your kitchen. This is just a flame, but look at the color. You know, you have a blue and you have a yellow, you have a red, you have orange, and it's so graphic and so beautiful, and it's a very, very simple picture actually. Yes. And that's the last one. That's my kitchen taken by me. I think I took this picture 30, 40 years ago. I remember one afternoon, the whole family had gone to sleep. And I do not sleep in the afternoons. So I had gone to the kitchen to had a glass of water. And I saw this picture because in the building outside the window on the wall, the sun was shining. So when the sun was shining behind the window, so this became a very nice silhouette. So I rushed and got my camera and I took this picture. So keep your eyes open and think, and I'm sure you will make great pictures. Wish you all the best.
Would you give any advice to cell phone photographers, considering you just mentioned that that the images have to be sharp, and with a cell phone that might not be the case, in case if there is, like, you know, the light is low in the house, and lately it's been very cloudy also.
See, today with the modern cameras, a cell phone, there are software which I think they should download, which gives you control of the aperture and the shutter speed. So they should do that. And the ISO is there to help you, no? Don't worry about grain, and I don't worry about grain, because at what size are you looking at the picture? So whatever is the ISO, your camera will take care of it. So even cell phone, and also I have seen and read that cell phones do also get attachments where you can make close-up pictures. So if he cannot get that, I remember, if you take your cell phone right close-up to the fruit or vegetable and see whether it is sharp or not, and then come back slowly until it is sharp. So I don't think that's a problem actually.
Okay, thank you so much.
Like even if you are using your camera and you don't have any close-up lens, you don't have a macro lens, you can you know, focus at the minimum distance and then move your camera. Don't touch your lens. So it may be 18 inches, maybe, I don't know, maybe 2 feet, 3 feet, whatever. So try to make a picture from that distance. It is possible. The whole thing is you have to look at shapes and forms and line and see if you can get shapes like triangle or circle or, you know, hexagon, anything.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Okay.